Let's get into introducing who Mr. Corsi is. Well, he earned his BA in hydrogeology from Georgia Southern University. Currently, Mr. Corsi lives and works in Chiang Mai, Thailand, where he does community development and micro-enterprising to alleviate poverty and fight human trafficking. Since poverty is one of the primary causes of human trafficking in northern Thailand, Mr. Corsi is working on the community level to assist families in developing agricultural products to provide income and create self-sustainability. Interesting how something like this can be used to do what? Fight human trafficking. Many of you have been to our community awareness symposium that we've done on human trafficking, and so it's really neat to see how there's an integrative, interdisciplinary approach to these issues. We're all interconnected. All of these things have an interconnection to them. So one of the projects that Mr. Corsi is involved in is aquaponics, and this is creating a system of farming which enables the farmer to produce crops and harvest fish in the same system. So, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, would you please welcome to the stage Mr. Preston Corsi.
Yeah, so I've been in Thailand for the last 4 years fighting human trafficking. And like I said, poverty is one of the main reasons why human trafficking happens over there. And so I got interested in aquaponics as we were looking at how to fight poverty. And aquaponics is really one of the tools that I use for developing communities. And so today I'm going to tell you, what is aquaponics, what's the parts to it, how do you make it work, how can you do it yourself? And also, how does it help when it comes to sustainable farming, or how does it help when it comes to using it as an alternative? Okay. All right, so the first big question, of course, is what is aquaponics? All right, so with aquaponics, really all it is a water system. It's a water system where you can actually grow plants, as you can see the plants in the bottom left, and actually harvest fish up in the top left there. And for understanding aquaponics, one of the easiest ways to understand it is by comparing it to hydroponics. Does anyone in here have experience with hydroponics? Okay, has anyone heard of hydroponics? Okay, like six hands, okay, maybe 10. All right, cool. So the main difference, actually with these two designs, I made them look very similar on purpose. You can see here with hydroponics, you have plants growing up top and a plant tray. In aquaponics, you have the same thing. You have plants up here. With hydroponics, though, the main difference is the bottom tank. For this one, you have an air pump, but you mainly have this pump that will take the water to the top. Okay, so that's for hydroponics. Now, with aquaponics over there, there is a pump that takes the water up to the top as well. But the main difference is that there are fish in the bottom tank. So it's a fish tank, right? Okay, aquaponics, aquaculture. So when you talk about aquaponics, you were talking about fish. The other difference with hydroponics and aquaponics is, for hydroponic units, a lot of what you do is you will go out to a shop and buy a nutrient solution to bring nutrients to the plants. So you'll like insert it right here, and then it'll be pumped up to the plants. With aquaponics, it's totally different. All the nutrients actually come from the fish. So what you do is you feed the fish, and then the fish do what's natural to them. They go to the bathroom, and the fish poo and the water will come up, and actually the plants will take care of the fish poo at that. And so how does it work? So I basically took that design from the last slide and made it big so you guys can see it. And we will go through basically a water flow through on how's the water flow through this thing. And actually, I'll use this unit right here. Hopefully all of you guys can see it. Everyone can see it, right? Raise your hand if you can't see it. Okay, no hands. All right, so in the bottom area here, you do have fish. Obviously, it's a fish tank. So with this unit, the water will be in here, and there is a pump right here that will actually pump out all the fish poo and the water. The pump will come up to the top tank here. And here in the top tank, the plants, in a way, will filter out all the fish poo. And they will take out all the nasty parts that actually are harmful to the fish. And so as the water comes through here, it will just flow right in here, right under here. You can see well enough, there are roots here that actually take up all the nutrients and things that might hurt the fish. And then it will come out through here, down this pipe, and just fall back down there. So with hydroponics and aquaponics, they're both closed units, which means that the water will not escape. The water is in there all the time, so you actually reuse the water over and over. So with aquaponics, there are three major biological parts to it. The first one we'll talk about is fish. And with fish, what you know about fish is you need to choose a fish that is best for your environment. In Thailand, we use tilapia and catfish. Thailand is terrible, but about 3/4 of the year, it's over 100 degrees, which is pretty hot. And tilapia is a hot weather fish. Tilapia survives survives in water that's temperature between 70 and about 85 degrees. So tilapia does really well there. The other type of fish that we use is actually catfish. Does anyone like catfish? Anyone ever eat it? Yeah, catfish tastes good. Thais like catfish too. Catfish is a very hardy fish. It's incredibly hardy, and it's a good fish to start with. In fact, when we were in Thailand, we decided to experiment with using catfish, and so we went out and bought some and used them in a system. Well, after we bought them, we put them in a big old tank, and then we left to get lunch. And as we were out eating lunch, we came back there and we saw that one of the fish had jumped out. And it was sitting there on the floor, and I swear it was dead. It was just like bait. It was like jerky. And I had heard about catfish and how hardy they are, so I told one of my friends, I said, why don't you just pick it up and throw it back in there? And so he threw it back in there, and it was kind of like, when you threw it in, it was like one of those pool torpedoes, you know, you throw it, it's just like, ooh. So it went right in, and it was just sitting there for a minute, and then it started moving. And the thing came back to life. I mean, it was like Frankenstein's monster. But, so yeah, catfish are very hardy. And so after being out in the sun baking for about 30 or 45 minutes, it did come back to life. So if you're interested in starting out aquaponics yet, a catfish is really hard to kill, so it's a good fish to start with. The other thing you need to know about fish is that the fish poo is the main thing that provides the nutrients for the plants. That's how aquaponics kind of starts. The other thing about fish is that they're sensitive to sudden water changes. So if you ever have like rain or anything get into your system, it may change the temperature, it may change the pH, and you could have a problem with your fish. Now, I'll be honest, fish is probably the most frustrating part of the system. When you have a problem with fish, you don't know you have a problem with fish until one dies. You know, when you have plants, you can look at it, if it looks like it's wilting, it's like, oh, it's too hot, or if you have a bug crawling on it, you know you need some pest control. But with fish, when there's a problem, they just die. So the main thing you have to do is, when you have one die, you need to figure out, okay, is this just a sick one, or is there a real problem? So you kind of got to investigate into it. The other thing with fish is that dissolved oxygen content is key. The best way to get dissolved oxygen into a fish tank is just by creating bubbles. Has anyone worked with aquarium before? No one. Okay. Wait, I think it's all open. Yeah, okay, one person. Alright. So one thing that you can buy for aquariums or with these things that are called air stones. These are just connected to an air pump. It's something that's really cheap. It's probably like $10. But all an air stone does is just pushes air in there and all this is bubbles. And that will bring up your dissolved oxygen. Interesting thing about that is tilapia here in this picture, obviously you can see some, there's a lot of bubbles here. The tilapia and most types of fish actually need dissolved oxygen. But catfish actually don't. They will actually come up to the top and breathe. They have what's called a swim bladder and it actually works like a lung. And so that's another reason why catfish are kind of a good fish to use for this when you're starting out. I also have here, use a filter to clean large poop particles. The good thing is, with most pumps that you buy, they actually have a filter in them. Filters are really easy to clean. All you do is take them out, they're just a sponge, and you rinse them out and just put them back in. The reason why this is important is for a unit like this, you know, poop can get stuck all over the place and actually take down the flow of your system, which may cause problems later. So you do need to find some way to filter it. That's my recommendation when it comes to aquaponics. The other thing is you need to choose your fish feed carefully. When I'm working with people on aquaponics, I always ask them, you know, what do you really want out of the system? Do you want just a bunch of plants and a lot of vegetables? Or are you more interested in harvesting a lot of fish? Because when it comes to harvesting fish, you need to choose the right type of fish feed. In Thailand, there are basically three types of fish feed. There's a 30% protein fish feed, there's 50%, and there's 70% protein fish feed. Now, with the protein, it's all about the protein for fish. If you want them to grow fast, obviously you're going to go with the 70% protein feed. But if you're not worried about fish at all, you can go with the 30% or 50%. So you do need to be careful when it comes to how you want to feed fish. Okay, so plants. Plants act as the filter for the fish. Really, the main thing that plants do and how they help the fish is they keep nitrate, nitrite, and ammonia levels down. Nitrate, nitrite, and ammonia are the things that will really irritate fish. And even if the levels are really high, they will actually kill fish. So that's how the plants really help these fish stay alive. They can also help control pH. I know a lot of farmers or a lot of people who use aquaponics who actually use the plants that they grow to feed the fish. So it can be used that way. But I will say this about using plants for feed is that they do not have a lot of protein. So if you're going to be if you want to be growing your fish, you're not going to be, you don't want to use just plants to feed your fish. You may want to use a supplement. The more dissolved oxygen there is in the plant tank, the faster the plants will grow. This was something we found out probably within about a year into it, which is kind of interesting. But the plants also use dissolved oxygen. You know, I thought it was just for fish, just to keep them alive, but we found out when we experimented with putting air stones into our grow tanks that the plants would grow at an exponential rate. So it's kind of interesting, but the dissolved oxygen content is important for plants as well. And finally, going back to filters are important, yeah. And with the plants, the filters will keep the roots clean. As the fish poo is coming through here, it will actually cling to the plants. And if you get plants that are, if you have roots that are looking brown, they aren't able to take as much nutrients up. So that's plants. Now, there is a third biological part. Does anyone want to guess what it is? What was that? That's close, actually, it's within that. This is a part that most people, you can't see it, so most people don't think about it. But bacteria. Bacteria is the primary reason why aquaponics works. Bacteria, well, first of all, it occurs naturally in our waters. So when you're doing aquaponics, you don't have to worry about getting bacteria. You actually can buy bacteria at a garden shop and put it in there just to kind of jumpstart your system. But it will naturally occur in your water system. But the big thing that it will help you with is converting ammonia into nitrite and converting nitrite into nitrate is incredibly important. As I like to put it, nitrate is what the plants need. Okay, so when it comes to plants, they need the nitrate, not the ammonia, not the nitrite, not anything like that, but they need nitrate. And so bacteria is the thing that helps that to grow. And the great thing about aquaponics is the older your system is, actually the better it will run. And the reason is really what you're doing with aquaponics is you're growing a bacteria colony. So they'll get bigger and bigger and stronger, and they'll be able to convert more of your waste into a product, really. Okay, so those are the biological parts of aquaponics. Now we're going to get into what it looks like, and we'll start with size. The principle is the same no matter what the size is. You can have small size, you can have large size. For the large size, the picture on the left is actually an aquaponics unit that I built for an orphanage. It's about an acre wide, it's as large as an acre, and you can see the picture on the right is actually the inside. And we have a bunch of cucumbers and I think tomatoes in there, and also some Chinese kale being grown at the time. Has anyone ever been to Disney World? Okay, that should be like everyone here, right? Okay. Epcot, anyone ever been on that ride in Epcot? It shows you aquaponics and you can go eat the food up top. Okay, go check it out. They have a very large aquaponics. And then there's also small scale. So the one on the left, I mean, I call these like backyard units. The one on the left, that's actually in front of my house, through my window. But these are like backyard units that, so the main thing here is that aquaponics can be any size you want. The picture on the right is actually two different systems. One is made out of concrete rings. And so I created that one to kind of help ties to understand that this can be used however you want it to be. built. Okay, so going into different types of aquaponics, this is going to be like not what the size is, but what it looks like, what it can look like. Okay, nutrient film technology. When I first read this word, I kind of get annoyed at it because it sounds like really high and mighty. I think some scientist or engineer was like, oh, let's come up with some cool name. Really, all it is a plant and a pipe. Okay, so you cut PVC, you make some holes, you put plants and pipes, and I'll have some pictures of these later on. But so don't be intimidated by nutrient film technology. You know, it's just a plant being grown in a pipe. The next one is deep water culture. This unit here on the stage, this is a deep water culture. Unit. Deep water culture, when I hear deep water, I think like 10, 15 feet deep, but it's really something that's like maybe 1-2 feet deep. And really, it's all, I call it a floating raft unit. You have a raft that's floating with the plants on top of it. And the final type of aquaponics that we have is a media-filled bed. And what this means is, like if you look at this unit up here, instead of having this floating piece of styrofoam here, you'll have actually rocks or some clay balls down there that fill the whole thing. The water will actually run through the whole thing and run out. Okay, so nutrient film technology. See, like I said, some pipes and some plants running out. Nutrient film technology is one type of aquaponics that's really helpful in the fact that it's, first of all, it's very cheap to do. PVC is really cheap. Thailand, it's really cheap here as well. It's easy to put together, and honestly, it's very versatile. I mean, you can put it anywhere. You can build one in here however long you want it to be. I've seen people actually connect these to the side of their house, or even go around trees. So it can be fixed up however you want it to be. The major problem with this type of unit is that you have to be careful with the type of plant that you choose. Okay, so here I think this is some type of like Chinese basil. That's like a short rooted plant, but plants with really long roots, you can't use in this. Like a tomato plant is probably about this big. Its roots though are probably about 5 feet long. So can you imagine a 5 foot long root in there? That's gonna clog the whole system. So you really can't use every type of plant with this type of system. All right, the next system is a deep water culture system. And like I said, it's just like this one here. And again, with deep water, all that means is like a foot to 2 feet deep. And we use styrofoam trays or rafts on top of these things, and we put the plants inside a cup and then the cup inside the hole there. But the main idea here is that the roots are kind of like free flowing within the water there. This unit is like a medium cost. One of the biggest things you have to be careful of with this unit is the container that you use to hold the water, it needs to be a strong container. Because when it comes to the strength of the container, really it's under the pressure and the weight of water, like 24/7. For what we have here, we actually have welded steel together and put in a tarp and some concrete boards to kind of hold it in. And if you don't have something really strong, it'll start to bow, and sooner or later it will crack. So you do have to be careful about that. The other thing about the foam is you really need to paint it with an acrylic paint. The acrylic paint, first of all, it kind of protects the foam from being like waterlogged. But the other thing is sometimes you'll have some pests or bugs that come in and actually drill in and put eggs in there, and then you have a huge problem. So you do need to be careful if you're going to do that about painting it. Okay, media filled beds. This is a lot like the deep water system, but obviously there's media in there. So you can use rocks or clay balls that are actually sold at most gardening places. But the other thing that you have to be careful of with this is, again, you have to have the right kind of container to hold the weight of it. I'm not sure if it's too clear here, but the black area back there is actually concrete. So this is in like a big concrete ring. So concrete's not going to bow with it, so that's why we kind of chose that for it. But with the media filled tanks, they can be the most expensive because one, you gotta find a strong material to hold them, but you also have to get a bunch of rocks and have them shipped over. You also have to clean them, and you need clean rocks. You know, a lot of these, you can see that most of these rocks are like kind of circular and rounded. Well, they're from a river, and most river rocks, they don't have any like chemical compound that kind of comes off of them. They don't start to break down during water all the time. If you get like a muddy type rock, you know, that's going to break apart and just turn mud in your system. So it is important what type of rocks you use. And the other great thing about the system is it's intuitive. You know, when it comes to gardening, you just kind of scoop out some soil and put it in. Well, this is kind of like the same thing, you just do it with rock. Okay, so those are our three types of units. Now we're going to get into developing communities. The big way that I have used this to help develop my communities in Thailand is, first of all, it helps by providing an alternative means of farming. You know, this is kind of an interesting thing to kind of look at and consider when it comes to farming in a different way. It also obviously creates two different types of products at the same time, fish and produce, vegetables, whatever you want to grow. But it also provides a new skill that someone can learn. They can learn about how to take care of fish. And probably my favorite part of aquaponics is it promotes critical thinking skills. I mean, as you're building this thing, you've got to kind of construct it. You got to think, okay, this needs to go first, what needs to go second, what needs to go third. Whenever you encounter a problem, you got to kind of step back and kind of almost redesign some things. So it promotes you to think far in the future about how to best work on things. Now, I want to go through advantages of aquaponics over traditional farming. First of all, aquaponics is versatile. You can use it anywhere. You can use this thing on the side of a mountain. You can use it on the side of a house. You can use it on a parking lot. You know, you don't have to go out and buy a piece of land that's for farming and use it specifically for that. The other thing about aquaponics is it can have a modular design. For instance, up here we have this little plant tank here, but if I wanted to, I could just build another one and just hook it here. I could build another one and just hook it here. As long as the water is just flowing this way down to the fish, you know, it will work. So you can build it so there's different components to it, and you can make it, and you can expand it as long as you want. The other thing that it does, it will alleviate water and land costs. With aquaponics, you really just have the initial cost of putting water into it. The rest of the time, the water will cycle through, so you don't really need to replace water. The only time you need to replace water is if there is a hole or a leak, or if you have some evaporation, which you probably will run into. And so with the other thing that it does, obviously, is produce both fish and vegetables. So you have protein in your diet, and you also have vegetables. Another advantage of aquaponics over traditional farming is it is organic. And in a lot of ways, you have to keep it organic, because everything you use for your plants, if you were to use like a harsh chemical to do pest control, that harsh chemical is going to get to the water, goes to the fish, and your fish will probably die. You know, so you have to be careful about what you do. So the good news is that you do get organic food, which is better for you. But we'll get into disadvantages later. And the final part is that you can actually build pest control into the unit. The unit is off the ground typically, and you can put like we put mosquito nets and roofs and stuff all over this thing. And so we can actually see where the insects and whatnot are getting in, and we can kind of control it there. Most of the problems with gardening, with pest control, is because gardening, all the pests come in up through the soil. So they'll come in through the soil and wreak havoc on your garden, whereas with this, you don't really have that problem because you don't have soil. Okay, when it comes to community development, you know, as I said, aquaponics is a tool that I use. So I like to kind of list what are the advantages, but we also need to know that there are disadvantages when it comes to using aquaponics for community development. First of all, there is a high upfront cost. You do have to build a unit. Okay, PVC is not that expensive, but some of the other things can be really expensive. In fact, this little unit I have up here on the screen, I think that's made out of concrete greens and actually some brick and PVC and whatnot. But that was probably $150, which isn't too much, but for a Thai person for a backyard unit, that might be a little expensive. So high upfront cost is one of the major disadvantages for it. The other thing is that it requires a basic understanding of water chemistry. If you don't know anything about pH, if you don't know anything about how to control temperature, you may have some problems. So if you don't have the resources to really kind of figure those things out, you'll run into issues. And when I'm working with communities, these are communities up like in the hills, so they don't have a lot of resources with a lot of things. A lot of chances to get in contact with resources. The other thing about aquaponics is they can be overwhelming to developing communities. I've done a lot of training on aquaponics with a lot of Thai people, and you know, I'll usually take them and kind of show them one of these units. And any of you guys can come up and figure this thing out. You can figure out, oh, okay, the water comes down here, I'll get pumped up here, okay, cool. But when I show them my larger units, I mean, they're like, where are all these pipes going? I don't even know what's going on here. And so it can be a little overwhelming when you're trying to get someone to understand, okay, this could be a big picture for you. And the final disadvantage for aquaponics is it is forced organic. A lot of these communities, they are farming communities, and a lot of times when they have any issues with crops and whatnot, they'll just go ask a friend and be like, what'd you do? And a lot of times the friends will just say, oh, well, I use this pesticide. And with aquaponics, like I said earlier, you can't use pesticides. So you really run into a problem. So sometimes, even though organic food is really good for you, making things organic is really tough. And so, of course, having it be forced organic can be a major disadvantage. So. Okay, well, I'd like to thank you guys for listening to me, and I think we're gonna open this up for Q&A.
By showing hands, did you guys learn something new today?
Yes.
Yes, that's very good. All right, so first question.
For the aquaponics system, what is the pH level? I know the pH level for hydroponics is 5.5 to 6.5, but what is it for the aquaponics?
In my experience, when you first start doing aquaponics, the pH will actually jump up to a 7. It will jump up to an 8, but actually after it's been running for a while, it actually stays around 7. Good question. Yes.
Yeah, you talk about the kind of fish. What I just got a text from my niece who studied some kind of stuff, and she tells me a tilapia, which I love. She told me stay away from it because it's harmful. What the way how it's done in aquaponics, could you have bad tilapia or tilapia is always good in the way how it's done with aquaponics?
I'll answer it this way. When we first started doing aquaponics, we actually worked on a fish farm. And you can get some mixtures of different species that may not be good, but a lot of times when it comes to tilapia, maybe what she's talking about is they do, when the tilapia are really young, and even when they get older, they will do like a gene therapy on them. Basically what they do is they give them a shot to make sure they're male. And so I don't know if that has some residual effects. The other thing that they do is they do give them shots to keep them from getting diseases. So that may cause some issues, but I've never had any issues like that in Thailand. So I'd be interested to hear more about what issues you may be.
You said the most important thing to grow this hydroponics is the bacteria. I think bacteria, I think that was something that's, Jeremy, you're bad, and I don't want to really get near it. Yeah. So how do we break that misconception?
Yeah, so this is good bacteria, actually. so with the bacteria, it does grow all over your system, but it's a water-based bacteria, so it's not like you're getting it in your mouth or anything like that. But yeah, so this is a good bacteria that helps break down things and actually keeps the fish alive.
Yeah. So does aquaponics change the quality of the vegetables or the fish that are produced from it? Like, are they of a worse or equal quality to regular farming?
That's an awesome question. I will say this, with on the fish side of things, no, not really, it doesn't change anything. I mean, it's just fish feed. It's the same thing you get when you have a farm-raised fish. But with the plants, you do have to add some, depending on what plants you're working with, you have to add some additives. The best plants that work with this are like leafy greens. Obviously, this is not a real plant. But you know, you want something like leafy greens, like lettuce. Those things grow really well. There's other plants that require a little bit more nutrients. With aquaponics, what we use for the potting mix is a coconut core, which is basically shredded coconuts. But the difference between aquaponics and regular farming is regular farming, you have soil. Soil has all these minerals, has all these components to it that the plants take in. Aquaponics, you still have to add some of that stuff in. So what we use is we actually use a chelated iron. And so whenever you're working with aquaponics and you start seeing your leaves turn a little yellow, we'll just put some iron in there and usually fix the problem. We have a seaweed mixture, actually like a kelp mixture that we put in there as well. And we haven't had any major issues where it's like, oh, this doesn't grow here. But yeah, that's an excellent question. It would require a lot of research.
I can holler. I project. Okay.
All right, cool.
So a lot of what you showed us are kind of backyard farmers. But what on the largest scale? What's out there? Are there aquaponics farms that are sustaining a large population of people?
Aquaponics is like a newer technology. I'll first of all say that. And with a country like Thailand, where it's still considered like a developing country, aquaponics is still like a kind of like a cool, interesting hobby technology. I will say in Bangkok that they do have a large aquaponics unit that's actually run by the king. Thailand does have a king, and he has king projects all over the place that focus on agriculture. And so they do. I'm not sure how well their production is on that type of thing, but I know they do it, and they tend to have success. But my main point in talking about developing communities is aquaponics, you have to decide if it's appropriate technology, and in a lot of instances, it may not be appropriate technologies. Honestly, aquaponics works best, in my opinion, it works best in an arid environment because you can really control the water in here. You don't need to add a lot of water all the time. And it works best in environments like islands where they don't have a lot of land for vegetables. Because vegetables, if you're working in a place where they have a ton of land, vegetables are going to be really cheap. But fish are going to be more expensive. On an island, like, fish are going to be cheap. Vegetables are going to be really expensive because you don't have a lot of land. So you need to be thinking about where to use it when it comes to development.
Thank you. And I
see
two more hands.
So like on a larger scale, is it like not less efficient or something?
No, it's the same. I mean, on a larger scale, I mean, you do have a lot more freedom to build and I guess it goes back to what do you want to get out of it? Do you want fish out of it or do you want plants out of it? Because honestly, with fish, you know, in a bucket like this size, I can probably do like 3 times the length of plants. So it can be really plant intensive. It just kind of depends on what you want and what that community is like looking for. And when it comes to community development, you have to decide what does the community need? Do they need like a new hobby? Do they need obviously they don't need a new hobby, but do they want to just make money? How do they make money? I mean, are fish the thing that you want to focus on or is it plants that you want to focus on? So it depends. I mean, with community development, there's a lot of parameters you need to have an idea of like what's going on. Answer your question?
Yeah.
What kind of fish do you recommend if we were to do it here in Florida?
Honestly,
tilapia more or catfish more?
If your unit is outside, I would say tilapia. One of the things you have to do with the fish tank is you do need to find some cover for it, so it's not just in direct sunlight all the time, or else your tilapia will be baking. But catfish is just as good, but actually tilapia do better in hot water. They do better than catfish in hot water. But it depends. I mean, if you don't want to invest money into having air in there all the time, catfish is the way to go.
Do you like buy that already made, or like, do you make it yourself?
This thing?
Yeah.
Oh, I made it myself.
Like if I wanted one, what?
Okay. This thing here. I'm sorry. What did you say? Finish that up.
Like if I wanted one, would I have to like make one? Like...
You just pay me $50 and like. Now, actually, this thing was probably less than $100 or so. It just depends on what tools you wanted to get for it. But they're not expensive. Just need to look in. Like this one, you could just take the design. I can give you the design for it, and you can just buy the stuff. This one, I decided to do like a clear. I'm not sure if this plastic is the best for holding water. I just wanted to get something clear that you guys can see under here and see what's going on. But this size is totally fine. I mean, you can connect this. Like instead of this being a plastic tank here, you can just put a regular aquarium at the bottom. So, but it's not very expensive. I mean. The thing is about aquaponics is there are so many forums online that you can find all different types of designs that you can use at home, actually.
So, I don't think there are any other questions from the floor. Oh, yes, they are. But I have three of my own, actually, so.
How much about, in terms of maintenance, let's say, because I heard all this bad stuff about tilapia, let's say, I want to do my own tilapia and have some plants on the side. How practical is it for me to set this up in my backyard and grow it myself? Just to feed me and my wife.
I would think it'd be, well, I'm going to say it is practical. I mean, you can do it. But how I'm going to answer that is by dealing with expectations. I mean, with this size unit, let's say you're going to do this exact size, you are not going to get an entire 3 days full of salad in 1 week out of this thing, okay? So, I mean, it takes about 4 weeks for lettuce to grow. Maybe 3 weeks to start getting tomatoes. So you have to kind of think about what are the cycles for plants. Typically with aquaponics, they do grow really fast. Maybe like half a week to a week faster than traditional farming. But it depends on what size you want to make it. With a fish, I would think if you're feeding it with a 70% protein level, they could probably be ready to eat in about, honestly, 2.5 months. So there is some time there. I mean, they have to grow up, so, right?
So the first thing I want to do is thank you for the work that you're doing. One of the things that I shared with Dr. Farrell earlier this week was that I happened to be watching PBS, I believe, and they were describing food deserts right here in America, which basically, for those of you who may not know, that a food desert is a community or neighborhood within, I guess anywhere that you really don't have access to a neighborhood grocery store or a place where you can get food readily available to you. So the work, so they talked about how hydro as well as aquaponics has been helping those areas that have been there's a shortage of food, so thank you so much for what you're doing. The first question I have would be, you talked about the tubes, you may have mentioned this, but what is actually helping that water move through each section? Does it have to be connected to an electrical source, or
right.
How does that work?
Well, you can hire someone to get a bucket and just that's a joke. we do have a pump here. So okay. this thing I got at Walmart for like $10 or so, maybe it was $15. And this is strong enough to pump it up here. And honestly, with pumps, I remember when I first started, I was like, oh my gosh, pumps, I don't know what to get. But pumps, you can just look on the back, it'll tell you how high it can go and how much water comes with the height. So you just have to read through the back. And they're not very expensive. When they get expensive, is honestly, it's dependent on how high the water is going. So if I had this box like all the way up here, like I would need a stronger pump. But if the box was just out here, I wouldn't really need a strong pump. So it's all about height when it comes to.
So one would have to have an electrical source.
For a traditional type.
And do you know of any research right now that's happening with maybe solar powered pumps, so where they're getting the energy from the sun?
They are out there. I know they are out there, but. So when I think about that, what I think about is actually fish. I'm not thinking about getting these plants watered, because honestly, if anyone does gardening here, you know you can water a plant like once a day and it's completely okay. But when it comes to fish, they're the ones who really need the electricity. They need the dissolved oxygen in there. So if you don't have access to electricity, you want to use catfish. Because what I said is the catfish will actually come up. They can come up to the top. Most catfish can come up to the top and the surface of the water and breathe air, actually, that way.
Thank you. My second, or I guess this is now my third question. You mentioned earlier in the presentation this link between the aquaponics and also human trafficking. So can you delve in deeper regarding that issue and that link and what's happening in Thailand?
Sure. So we do a lot of anti-human trafficking work, and community development is just a part of it. We also do like what we call restoration and prevention. So restoration is more focused on helping people who have been trafficked get back on their feet, start having a good life again, and start getting advice for that. But when it comes to prevention side, that's community development. Because a lot of times in Thailand, when it comes to human trafficking, what happens is you have a poor community and you have like a really poor family who they can't seem to make money. And sometimes you'll have a rich person come in and say, hey, I got a restaurant in the city, so you have a girl or boy, and if you want, they can come work for me. And it turns out it's not really a restaurant. So that's kind of how human trafficking happens over there. And a lot of times parents have no idea that's going on. And sometimes with Thailand, they kind of deal with a lot of shame. So the kids who are being trafficked, they may never tell the parents because they don't want to bring shame on the family. So by helping alleviate poverty, we actually are helping to alleviate trafficking.
Thank you. And then my last question would be, we also heard from your bio that you received your undergrad in hydrogeology, correct?
Right.
So can you explain to us a little bit more about what that is and how did you come to understand at such a young age that that is where you wanted to, the field that you wanted to study? So tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, so I was always interested in science when I was in college. And I remember I went to a geology class, mostly because a girl was going to the geology class. And but I really liked science, and geology was one of those things where it's like, you can see it, you can touch it, you can really see it happening. So I started getting involved with geology that way. And once I started going down that major, they started talking about hydrogeology, which, that's a really fancy word for groundwater. Learning how groundwater kind of flows through the environment. And so I decided to pursue that, mostly because I was interested in going across seas or working in America and working with people to help them get water and help alleviate some issues that they might have. So that's how I got involved with hydrogeology.
Thank you. So I think I asked a whole lot of questions. Were there any more from the floor? Okay, if they're not, let's give Mr.